Hello there everyone, my name is Zed, and I'm glad to have you with me on my very first My Downtime I Play series. Simply put, this series is about me reviewing the game that I have played before, but if you prefer a written review instead of watching one, you can check out my written review for me over down in the description box below. Now, before I begin, I would like you viewers to know that this review contains the base game only and it is based on Miss Over version 1.0.8. Let's begin, shall we? And so, during my downtime, I played Miss Over. So what is Miss Over? Well, Miss Over is a roguelike mystery dungeon crawler developed and published by Krafton. Many have compared Miss Over to Darkest Dungeon, and it can't be helped as the atmosphere given off from it and the art direction Miss Over have taken is rather similar upon first impression about its vibrant and colorful tone. What sets it apart immediately is that Miss Over has waifus. You heard that right, fellow weeb? Anime waifus. You get them even without installing any mods. On a serious note, the feeling of familiarity to Darkest Dungeon doesn't linger beyond a few minutes. The backdrop to the Miss Over story is that humanity has been pushed to the brink of destruction ever since the appearance of a massive vortex crystal pillar of darkness. With its appearance, mist begins to spread across the lands and monstrosity known as Esper spill forth from its depths. As the final frontier of humanity, Alta, an exploration group was founded with the sole purpose of exploring the vortex, hoping that the key to ending the apocalypse lies within. The gameplay of Miss Over can easily be divided into three segments, town activity, exploration, and combat. Let's talk about the first segment, town activity. The town has numerous facilities to help you in your preparation before you venture into the dungeon. New characters can be recruited through the Expedition Center, and new skills can be taught from the Training Center. Your skill points are needed to learn new or improve existing skills. It can be obtained when your characters level up. Among all of the facilities within the town, my favorite place to be is at the shop, and here's why. The shop is run by a cheerful shopkeeper named Mary. A bright smile coupled with the shop upbeat theme is a stark contrast to the groaning and ominous sound through most of the game, and it's also the place to get food, potions, and other essentials before diving into the dungeon. It is best to drop by the office to collect any available mission, though you can ignore it if you just wish to grind. Undertaking this mission allows you to progress with the game's story, and some of it provide backstories to the life of the NPCs that's living within the town. These missions are to be completed within the dungeon, and they are generally constructed around finding specific objects or killing specific enemies. You can have up to 5 characters in a party, and they can be set into formation along in a 3x3 grid. Whether a skill can be used is dependent on where the user is standing, and the party will receive a slight boost in stats based on its formation. This should sound pretty similar to the Darkest Dungeon 1x4 grid, minus the boost in stats. Exploration sees your party navigating through a semi-randomly generated grid-based map as you go about your business. Every dungeon has its own unique monster and theme, such as the cursed town being a maze, and the cathedral ruin having large rooms with narrow connecting corridors. This makes each dungeon has its own set of challenges for you to overcome. As your characters traverse through the dungeon, your hunger and luminosity meter goes down with every step taken. You will find yourself keeping a close eye on those meters so as to not starve to death or crouch around in the darkness. This requires you to ration the supplies that you have brought along as you explore the dungeon. Different characters have different exploration skills. The sister doubles your party health regeneration rate when you're out of combat, and Omnyoji disarms traps and can see through invisible units. Though it's best to focus around combat instead, as having certain characters in the party definitely makes certain dungeons to be a walk in the park to explore. Combat in Miss Over takes place between two parties, yours and the enemy. The unused space in the 3x3 grid adds another layer of depth to the combat. Some characters have skills to push or pull their target, thus effectively denying them from activating certain skills or attacks due to their new position while also affecting the bonus stats the party has based on their formation. Besides the default attack, your characters require MP to activate their skills, and the only way to recover MP is by blocking or walking around the dungeon. Some of the characters such as the Ronin doesn't conform to this rule. He has his own MP system and it increases as he attacks or secures a kill. Managing your party MP is vital as you explore the dungeon, as it may make or break your party in the next fight. With that being said, combat on Miss Over is relatively fair and it is in no way difficult. Moments such as, really? 90% chance to hit and I still miss? are few and far between. More often than not, this situation can be easily mitigated with the right equipment. Any misfortune that occurred is mostly your own. Forgetting to bandage your characters after a battle to which they die from bleeding out, or not bringing enough supplies to the dungeon and cause your party to die from hunger are incidents due to your own negligence. Once you have left the dungeon, the Doomsday Clock will appear. The Doomsday Clock acts as an encouragement for you to progress with the story, or a deferment so as you won't grind 24/7. When the hand of the clock strikes midnight, the vortex will ravage the land and the game will be over. To revert the hand as far back as possible, you are to kill every single enemy, open every chest, and break every crate in the dungeon. Failing to achieve this or having any of your party member dead will accelerate the clock. If you are thinking of having your high level characters to grind for loot at a dungeon beneath the party level, that too will move the hand forward. Any unidentified loot can be taken to the alchemy workshop back in town to unlock hidden stats for those equipment. As there are different levels of grade in equipment, the higher level will grant additional stats. You can fuse those equipment with another to boost its base stats. Naturally, the better grade equipment has a higher fusion limit. Though it's possible to increase the maximum fusion limit, it can only be done when the wearer dies in the dungeon. Those will have their fusion cap raised, but it will come at the cost of your characters and the item being cursed. One of the things that I like about Miss Over is how proactive the developers are at the forums. They actively listen to the community and acknowledge and rectify any bugs found in Miss Over within the next patch. A minor gripe that I have with Miss Over, along with a few others, is that originally there is only a single color palette per class, but as of update 1.0.4, you can change the tone and colors of your favorite characters due to popular demand. The Doomsday Clock mechanic is the one mechanic which the collective community and players of Miss Over hates, and because of this, the developers have given them the freedom to adjust the gameplay to their own pace. Though in my honest opinion, I like the Doomsday Clock as the way it is. It provides a certain degree of pressure for me to continue the story instead of grinding for gear 24/7. The thing I dislike about Miss Over is that learning a new skill or two consumes SP, and considering that the max level in Miss Over is 20, SP is a limited resource which can be gained only by leveling up. But with the developers giving the players a free rein on what factors we want to adjust, this problem that I see is no longer there. The downside of adjusting your gameplay instead of sticking on how it was meant to be played is that you will get a numerical score at the end when you complete the game. So at the end of the day, the number have no significant meaning at all. Overall, Miss Over pretty much does its own thing, and any resemblance to Darkest Dungeon is nothing but a misconception in the first few minutes of the game. Those that would like to have another Darkest Dungeon experience but without its gruesome RNG or a great roguelike strategy, Miss Over should not be missed. And for that, I rate Miss Over 8 out of 10. Is Miss Over worth playing during your downtime? Yes it is. It's especially so if you enjoy roguelike genres and anime in general. You can get Miss Over for $35 or your region equivalent. You can always wait for it to be on a sale. Miss Over is available on the PC, PlayStation 4, and Nintendo Switch. And for this review, Miss Over is reviewed over on the PC. You can play Miss Over on the controller, or if you don't have one, it is playable on the mouse and keyboard as well. If you remain undecided, you can take a look at my non-commentary walkthrough for Miss Over or try out the Miss Over demo. The link for the walkthrough and the demo can be found in the description box. I hope my review is helpful to you, and if you'd like to see more reviews and non-commentary gameplay, please subscribe to my YouTube channel. I hope to see you all next time. See ya!